Good morning. My name is Jesse Richard, and I work at the Recording Industry Association of America, and I'm also a member of the board of the Internet Education Foundation. I am pleased to introduce your next speakers this morning. First, we have FTC Commissioner Rebecca Kelly Slaughter. Commissioner Slaughter was sworn in last May, and before that, she served as senior counsel to Senator Chuck Schumer, whom she advised on a range of issues, including privacy, competition, and consumer protection. Before that, she worked at Sidley Austin in D.C., and she earned both her bachelor's and J.D. from Yale. Interviewing her this morning will be Alexis of Bloomberg BNA, who covers antitrust issues.
Well, thanks, Commissioner, for sitting with us today. This is an honor talking with you.
Thanks. It's such a pleasure to be here and to see such a packed, full house.
So there's so much we could talk about. I wanted to start off talking about the government shutdown.
Yeah.
And that must have been fun.
That was terrible. I mean, it was really, really terrible. I was going to work every day across the street. It was incredibly depressing. It was incredibly lonely. And it was really, I felt really upset about its effect, not just on our work, which was material, we had to stop it, but also on our staff and the message that it sent to them about you know, the work that they did. Their work is really important. They do it because they love it and because they love our country and they want to work. You know, the people who suggested that it was sort of just a fun paid vacation discount both the economic hardship that was real and the fact that people take pride in the work that they do. And so that was terrible. And then on top of that, I continue to be really upset about the effects on the contractors, you know, the people who provide security for our building, the people who work in the cafeteria, the janitorial staff. They don't get back pay like federal workers do. Some people are talking about that. I think it's a really important issue, and it continues to really bother me.
So this is coming, of course, at a time when the commission is in the middle of some very important and high-profile investigations, including the investigation of Facebook's privacy practices. So I'm wondering, what impact did the shutdown have on your agency?
We had to stop. I mean, we had to stop basically everything, work on anything that wasn't a very narrow range of matters that had that were deemed to have an immediate effect on property or life under the statute, but there's not a lot that we do that has that consequence. So all of our investigations basically had to stop. There were a few matters in litigation that continued because the judges said they were gonna continue, but all of the ongoing investigative work was shut down, and that's really lost time that we're never gonna get back. So everybody is working extremely hard and with enormous dedication to make up for lost time, to get back up and running. But we have a backlog of things that have piled up in addition to all the things that we wanted to be doing during the time that we were shut down. So it's very frustrating.
Can you comment on to what extent this may have sort of put you off track in terms of the Facebook case?
Well, I can't comment on that or any other specific case, but I will say that I think it slowed us down in all the things that we want to do. And we want to be faster anyway, and it is very hard to do that when you literally don't have staff and can't do work under the law. So yeah, it's not good.
I want to talk about a case that was announced yesterday. This isn't a tech specific case, but I think it does have implications for the tech sector. Yesterday, both you and your fellow Democratic Commissioner Rohit Chopra dissented against the Commission's approval of a merger between Staples and Ascendant. And what's, I think, interesting about that case is that it deals with a vertical merger where the two companies don't compete directly. And, you know, as you know, traditionally, the antitrust regulators have focused more on the horizontal cases where there's direct competition. So I want to talk about that. I think in your dissent, you mentioned that there's a need for the FTC to sort of crack down on vertical activity across the economy, and I'm assuming that includes the tech space. So can you talk about why you think there needs to be greater attention here and what kind of enforcement changes you're proposing?
Sure. So I think for a very long time it has been understood that there can be anti-competitive harm from vertical mergers as well as from traditional horizontal integration. That's well established in academic literature. There have been some enforcement cases, but there also has been a sort of prevailing view for the last several decades that vertical mergers are mostly good or mostly fine or good and rarely bad. And I'm not sure I agree with that view. In fact, I am sure I don't agree with that view necessarily. I think that we have to look very seriously at all the theories of potential harm from vertical mergers. And I think we have to look very skeptically at all the claimed benefits. I wrote a rather lengthy dissent in this case to talk about basically what I think of as the history of vertical enforcement and what I think we need to be doing better. But the top line conclusions that I came to are we need to investigate harm seriously, we need to look skeptically at claimed benefits, and that means doing what the law requires, which is having parties substantiate the benefits that they claim, not merely sort of hand-waving and saying, but there are benefits, and you should take those at face value. Because when we analyze a merger, we want to make sure if we find harm and there are claimed benefits, that those benefits really outweigh the harm and don't just minimally offset it in some way. And then we should bring enforcement actions if we think that there is meaningful harm and not offsetting benefits. And a lot of these cases are hard, because in vertical mergers, it's not just about predicting market share, it's about predicting how companies will behave when they're vertically integrated and whether they will actually engage in the anti-competitive conduct about which we might be concerned. So we have to make predictions when we do it. And we do the best we can making predictions with the evidence that we have at the time of the merger. But sometimes those predictions are going to be wrong, just because predicting behavior isn't a perfect science. And so what I hope that we will do where we have a close case or we have a theory of harm that isn't enough for us to bring a court challenge, but where we think, well, if the companies behave in X manner, it will be anti-competitive, what I propose that we do is in advance say, we're going to be doing a retrospective on this case. We're going to come back in a couple years and take a close look at what our predictions were, whether we were correct, and if we were wrong, at a minimum, learn from that so that going forward we can make better predictions in future cases, and if necessary, take any corrective action or enforcement action to address anti-competitive conduct or anti-competitive effects of the merger. The ability for enforcers to go back after the fact and break up a merger that turned out to be anti-competitive is a really important backstop that we should not be afraid of using as appropriate.
There have been some concerns about mergers in the tech industry where you have big tech companies like Facebook, like Google, that are swallowing up smaller companies. With that approach that you're talking about, could that address that concern?
Sure. I think it makes a lot of sense where we have concerns that a previous merger decision didn't get it right for us to go back and take a close look at it and say, what did we predict? Were we correct? Did this merger turn out to be anti-competitive? And what can we do about it now?
In your dissent, you did mention the idea about retrospective investigations, and I think your Republican colleagues rejected that proposal, citing resource constraints. So I just want to give you a chance to respond to their concerns.
Yeah, so first of all, I share their concern about our resource constraints. I've talked a lot about how I think we should have more and better resources, both in terms of general authority, but also really in terms of budget. A fact that has always stuck in my mind is that we had 50% more full-time employees at the Federal Trade Commission in the beginning of the Reagan administration than we do today. And when you think about that fact and how big and how fast our economy has grown in the intervening years, that is doesn't make a ton of sense to me. So yeah, I think we need more money. But I disagree with the majority that doing targeted retrospectives in close cases would require unlimited resources. It's a little bit circular. Either there are so many close cases that this would be a massive resource suck, in which case that suggests that we're not getting it entirely right if there are that many close cases that we're clearing, or there aren't that many close cases and we can do it in a targeted way. So if there are a ton of close cases, it's even more important for us to be thinking carefully about what we did and how to get it right in the future. And if there aren't that many close cases, it won't be a huge resource suck. But I certainly would support the addition of more resources for us to improve retrospectives and improve our general ability to be aggressive in investigations.
What would you say are the biggest challenges facing the FTC in the tech space right now? And does your agency currently have adequate resources and authority to address those challenges?
Yeah, so resources, I would say, is one of our very biggest challenges, again, for the reasons that I just discussed. I also think, shifting gears a little bit from the antitrust side, we have some authority challenges on the Bureau of Consumer Protection side. And that specifically is that the FTC, unlike many of its sister agencies, doesn't have general APA rulemaking authority. So what we cannot do under current law is set up clear rules of the road for data protection, data privacy, or issues that might be in our jurisdiction. We also don't have the authority to issue financial penalties for a first-time violation. And incidentally, we don't actually have the authority to independently issue financial penalties in any case. If we have a company that has violated the law before, we put them under order, make them promise to behave better, and then if they break those promises, we can find violations and either get the company to agree to pay money to resolve those or go to a court and ask a court to impose a penalty. But we don't have the authority to independently issue fines or issue penalties. I think that second offense, money not being on the table until the second offense, is a problem. I think not having rulemaking authority is a problem. And I think it's a problem for industry as well as for enforcement, because I think everyone would benefit from our ability to set clear rules of the road and to set clear expectations about how companies should behave with respect to consumer data. We have this right now in certain sectoral laws that allow some of the data to be protected some of the time. But that doesn't make a ton of sense in today's economy, where every company has a technological component and every company handles personal data, and data doesn't stay in sector-specific silos the way it might have when, say, HIPAA was passed.
I think we have time for one quick question, if anyone in the audience has one.
Is physical harm from
cybersecurity?
Okay. Yeah, so the question was about harm with respect to cybersecurity threats and how we think about it. I think what I would say is there is a very large universe of potential danger when it comes to data privacy and cybersecurity, and it ranges from sort of more intangible things like a sense of loss of personal autonomy over your data to very real, very concrete threats like the hacking of a medical device that could actually kill somebody. That's a pretty broad spectrum, and there's a lot in between it. I think we need to be flexible and cognizant of a whole variety and range of harms and think about it in the way that people really experience it and not just sort of in an abstract legal concept.
Thank you. Well, I think we're at the end now. And if everyone could just join me in thanking Commissioner Slaughter for her time today.
Thank you.